clothing lines for people with disabilities have now become popular. Target and Zappos are just two of the companies that now have adaptive clothing lines. These clothing lines provide inclusion with mainstream society among the disability community. Now, well-known fashion designer Tommy Hilfiger has a clothing line called Tommy Adaptive. Different Enable has the privilege of speaking with Gary Sheinbaum, the Chief Executive Officer of Tommy Hilfiger Americas, about Tommy Adaptive. As CEO, Gary leads the North American division as well as directs Tommy Hilfiger's Latin America operations. Since joining the company in 1995, Gary has worked in various capacities, including President of Specialty Retail, President of Retail Development for the U.S. wholesale business, and Group President of North America for Outlet, Specialty Retail, and e-commerce.
How have you seen the fashion industry today change from when you first started out in the fashion industry?
Quite a bit. And like so many things in this world, technology and digital media have really transformed the way we do business and the way we connect with our consumers. It's been an amazing, and it's happening at such an accelerated pace, you know, over the last few years. And geez, even during this COVID pandemic, it's unbelievable how just the whole digital and e-commerce space has accelerated so much on the way people are shopping and engaging with brands.
Yeah.
The other thing is it's how we market our products, also how we sell our products. We have digital showrooms. We're doing quite a bit of virtual market appointments. I mean, just so different from the way it used to be. You know, what we've seen is that in today's world, you have to really adapt to change very, very quickly, because it's coming at us fast. That's the one that you can count on. Things are going to change and evolve. And the consumer needs and the consumer demands and the way they shop, it's all moving very quickly. So as a whole, though, one of the big things I'm seeing, which is very encouraging to me, is how the industry as a whole is becoming so much more focused on sustainability and inclusion and diversity. And for us, it's really integrated now into everything we do. We know we have a long way to go, but it's a big priority for us to be focused on sustainability in many ways and inclusion and diversity, which has always been a very big part of our DNA anyway, you know, but it's just moving much faster now, and that's encouraging.
Yeah, absolutely. And do you think that it's moving much faster because of the pandemic in particular?
I think a lot of things that have happened around us, you know, in the world.
But online shopping, and there's different ways, pandemic, virtual.
Yeah, the pandemic has accelerated e-commerce across the board everywhere. I mean, the penetration of e-commerce, the amount of business everyone's doing, that's where so much of the action is. And it'll be interesting to see when things normalize and when that starts to really take hold, it'll be interesting to see where the penetrations fall. I think it'll balance out back into bricks and mortar more than now, but I think you'll see that this behavior of online shopping is here to stay and going to continue.
Yeah, I think, I mean, with the pandemic, whatever it may be, I mean, the world has changed. I mean, most of my shopping online, I'm a big shopper and I love clothes. So, but I mean, you're right. I think it's going to, you know, continue. I mean, I don't even know if stores will exist, quote unquote. I'm just saying in terms of like, it's become a new norm or a new reality of daily, you know, just order online and then send it back if it doesn't, you know, fit.
Yeah, I think it's always about balance.
And, I agree.
I think when everything settles down, yes, online will continue to grow and be so important to the way people shop. But they also like the social part of stores.
No,
they
agree.
Touch, feel, and try on and all of that. So I think we'll see a good balance. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And that was kind of a joke because I prefer going to a store as well. especially, you know, for sure.
Yeah.
What was the inspiration to start Tommy Adaptive?
Well, you know, I think it starts with who we are and who we've been, which has really always been about the democratization of fashion and being inclusive. From Tommy's early days in his own stores before he became Tommy Hilfiger, they were called People's Place. And it was all about a very diverse group of people working there, as well as consumer base. So we've always had that baked into who we are. Mm-hmm. It's always been part of our values. But what really inspired it was when I met Mindy Shire, because I wasn't even aware that there was such an incredible lack of any attention given to this by the fashion industry. It was completely overlooked. And you know, when you think about the attention on race, gender, and sexuality, those things have been getting attention over the years, but people with disabilities were completely overlooked and underserved. And in some cases, for when it comes to mainstream brands and real fashion brands, not served. And so as soon as we became aware of that from Mindy Shire in my first meeting with her, it was, to me, the light bulbs were going off. Oh my God, we have to do this. This is so much about who we are and how we think about doing the right thing in the world. And so it was a very exciting moment for me. And immediately, I said, we'll be the first global lifestyle brand to lead a movement, because this really is there to be done. And that's what excites us. It's not just about us doing it. It's about getting the world to change the way they look at people with disabilities, the biggest minority in the world. 1 in 4 people have a disability. Those numbers have even gone up since we started this. It all started where we just looked at Mindy and we said, oh my God, no mainstream brands are really doing this. Let's do it. And it was a non-for-profit, Runway of Dreams is. So we started with her very much in the spirit of, okay, let's do a kid's line. Cause Oliver, her son,
right,
was the kind of the inspiration. And so we said, all right, let's together, we'll put a kid's line together. And we'll put it on Tommy.com and let's see how that goes. Well, I got to say, I went up for the first shoot of where the product was being shot on these kids with disabilities that Mindy had brought in and their families. And oh my God, it was maybe one of the most emotional moments I've had, where you just see these kids for the first time being able to button and unbutton and dress themselves independently. And that look of, oh my God, I can have self-esteem and confidence, and the parents just seeing their faces. I immediately said to Mindy after that moment, we need to do so much more. This needs to be for men's, women's, kids, accessories, footwear, whatever we can do. This is such an opportunity to service this, you know, underserved community and do the right thing here. But in order to do that, we'll have to think differently than just the non-for-profit approach. They can complement each other, but we need to really get behind this. And over time, we talked about starting a division at PVH, which we did. And now we've been able to put a lot more resources behind it and develop all these products.
It's absolutely amazing. What I think is great about you guys, I mean, of course, it's mainstream, you know, Tommy Hilfiger, everyone knows what Tommy Hilfiger is. And I think like a lot of other, like you said, mainstream designers, whether it be Polo Ralph Lauren or... you could say The Gap too, J. Crew. I know that you used to work at J. Crew. But anyways, my whole point is that like all of these mainstreams, you guys are all fashion like centered, not just in terms of athleisure wear. And I think being in something that's not athleisure wear even boosts confidence. I'm happy to see that with you guys.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, people with disabilities have the same mindset. We're all the same in how we think and want to feel good about ourselves. We want to be comfortable. We certainly like to be able to dress ourselves, right? And many of us take that for granted. But there's many people who look at their closet every day and they don't have the options and or the ability to with the clothes that exist. So this has really been an amazing thing to watch. And the whole process from day one was about co-creation with the community. We didn't have the language. There were no benchmarks, right? Mm-hmm. It was like a zero base. It's like, okay, here's the world. We know that there's many people with disabilities. We know there's no brands really doing this at this level. So what are those modifications we need? And the only way to learn about it was to really work with the community. So it was an interesting process how this went down, because when I first said to Mindy and her team, I really believe the way to move this forward in a significant way and truly lead a movement, we're going to need a for-profit division. And PVH is uniquely qualified to do it, because we have multiple brands, but also we know the DNA and the mindset of Tommy Hilfiger and PVH to be inclusive, to think this way. So we put a business plan together, And we went to Manny Chirico, who's the CEO of PVH, the whole portfolio. And he's a great person who also wants to do the right thing. He immediately loved the idea, but he said, Gary, you're working too hard to sell me on it. The same way Mindy, within 5 minutes, I told her we're in when she had her pitch to me. And he said, but let's validate it. So we brought in experts. We brought in Boston Consulting Group. They loved it. They immediately validated the business plan and said, yes, there's so many people. This is a global opportunity, and so on and so forth. And the numbers made sense to them that there is a white space. So when I look at a business opportunity, I think, is there a white space? Does it fulfill a need or solve a problem? And is it purposeful? And this checked those boxes in a big way. And Boston Consulting Group validated all that with from a financial point of view and a market, scoping the market potential, right? And then we got in with a company called Firefish, because to us, and they do focus group and research work. And we said, before we do anything, let's really understand and get fact-based data around who this consumer is, what their needs are, and let's think about it in a co-creation way. And so Firefish did all these focus groups. We learned, and still are learning today, unbelievable amounts of things from this community. And so we actually coined it as adaptive apparel. We weren't sure what to call it. Interestingly enough, with the name of your business, it was, we were calling the customer differently abled, mm-hmm. but the reality was they didn't want to be called that specifically, right? Mm-hmm. They're just people, right? They don't want to be known by their disability. It's just a part of their lives. Mm-hmm. And so we had to be very careful even with the language, because we want to relate to these consumers and these people in a way that makes sense for them. So a lot of learning on the most fundamental level, all the way up through what are those modifications they're looking for. Someone who's seated in a wheelchair, someone who's got a cognitive challenge, someone who's got a limb difference. I mean, there were so many different things, which is what I think also makes it so complex and probably deterred many brands from getting into it. This is not easy work. And it's not like there's one size fits all solutions, right? No. So it's complicated and challenging, but well worth it. And we've made lots of progress.
Yeah, no, you definitely have. And I've seen some of the clothing. Well, I've seen all the clothing, but on the website, and it's amazing.
Yeah. And what we also saw was that it was a situation where you had to be end to end on your solutions. So it was like, okay, what's the packaging we're going to ship this product in? Because it can't be difficult to open up, right? Everything from the inception all the way to the consumer, we're trying to think it through very, very carefully. And we partnered with a company called Possible to be our strategic marketing partner. And then they were recently or subsequently purchased by Wunderman Thompson, a big agency, who has now started a division with one of the women who had physical challenges at Possible during this process of working with them. Mm-hmm. And she now heads up a division at Wunderman Thompson, where they took this so seriously to get involved with it. But like, for example, we were doing a commercial for the adaptive business, and we had very high level famous people who heard about what we wanted to do through the Possible team when we put it out there, the brief, and people writing things why they wanted to do it and have this project. And we actually wound up hiring a legally blind guy to produce this and to direct it. And it was an amazing, amazing effort. So staying authentic, we find, is critical every step of the way, listening and learning and co-creating with the community. These are all things that have really been, you know, kind of the way we've gone about it.
Yeah, for sure. And yeah. Now I know Mindy with her son, Oliver, who has muscular dystrophy. Was there any like personal connection to you with, you know, a family member or, you know, family friend or whatnot who had a disability where you actually saw, you know, on a personal front?
Yes, I do. I have a niece. I have a father-in-law. Yeah, okay. I've got a number of people in my life. Okay. So it hits close to the heart, yeah. You know, and I think many people do have someone in their lives, right? That have challenges. And what we have found is that, you know, when people come to shop our site, a very big percentage of them. So one of the fundamental things we had to think about is, from a business point of view, why do for profit, right? Well, first of all, because you can develop the team and the resources to get things done at a pace much faster than in a non-for-profit. And we have sourcing capabilities, technology, innovation people, all this kind of work, right, that we could do. But what we found is that there were some really interesting things that we saw happening. 35% of these adaptive customers coming to our customer service area were saying thank you to the customer service department. That doesn't normally happen, right, in customer. And we found that that 91% of adaptive consumers coming to Tommy.com were new to the brand. So one of the reasons I'm saying this is because if the business model works and you can get good traction and do business, what happens is it allows you to keep funding the innovations and the product and the modifications and everything to make it even better and to do a better job getting the word out and a better job leading a movement to get other brands to say, oh, wow, if that's successful like that, we should do it, you know? And so that's really important to us. 50% of those customers that were looking for adaptive product, okay, again, they were all new to the brand mostly, were also buying our non-adaptive product, okay? So they go on the site, and so that's another good KPI that says, this is healthy for our overall brand in so many ways, right? Mm-hmm. But as that is, as you can make a better business case, you can fund the mission better. And that's really why you want to get this whole thing working. And we also saw that of consumers, people, when we'd be in focus groups or when people learn about the fact that Tommy Hilfiger is doing adaptive apparel and modifications for people with disabilities, they now think about the brand differently. They want to engage with the brand. And what we've seen is 2 out of 3 were more inclined to actually shop our brand or talk positively about the brand. So again, the business case of why is this a positive thing that other brands hopefully take note of over time as we get more and more traction and more awareness out there so that we can just make it so that most brands are looking at it. And one of the topics that we used, or one of the things we used in our business model, was think about where plus size for women, you know, plus size women, just even starting there, where that was 50 some odd years ago, the forgotten woman, right? So, you know, now that's over a $20 billion business. And we've seen you can't underserve people. We have to be inclusive. And you see the world is moving more and more in a number of these areas in that way. So I think from a timing point of view, this is the time to seize the moment. And brands know that if you're not being purposeful, if you're not lining up with things like around the sustainability, long-term loyalty from consumers, you know, you're going to be challenged. So it's really almost table stakes, right, in some of these areas. And we want this to become just that way for adaptive.
Yeah, no, totally. So what's the design process like, and what kind of was the backstory? So, I mean, this also includes like the modifications that you use. How do you kind of come up with an item and the way that it's done? Because obviously you include all different types of disabilities. So there's probably lots of different
models. You know, look, it was all about what are those modifications when we're working with the community that they need, and trying to understand and segment them out a little bit. But some of them were really pretty universally helpful. Our magnetic zipper on our outerwear piece that you just click it and zip with one hand, or open up the piece like this and then magnetically it comes back together, the whole zipper and also the bottom. You don't have to work putting it in, right?
Right.
So that kind of thing, we just saw such a need for that. And that was for lots of different, that solved a lot of problems for different kinds of people, whether you had a limb, one arm that didn't work, or if you know, just didn't have the dexterity, all those kinds of things. Certainly magnets were a very big part of the solution. So magnetic shirts, you know, where you can just literally go like this and close. It was so great to see these kids to be able to do that. And these, everyone that's using those things. And so we just looked at all the ways people put clothes on, the neck openings, creating opportunities to open things up easier, back entries into things, you know, different ways to pull your pants up with loops that you put in to help also with that. And it goes on and on. We really, all the ideas for the most part were coming out of the community and just by learning through our focus group work and our engagement with the community. We early on sent out a lot of product to people with disabilities and said, all we ask that you do is come onto this community site, talk to each other, let's get some dialogue and give us your constructive feedback so we can do a better job for you. And that was really helpful. So it's an ever ongoing process. We're always learning.
So the Tommy Adaptive website is a shop by solution based, has a shop by solution method. How did you guys come up with such an amazing idea?
Yeah, you know, so it always comes down to what's going to make it easiest for someone to navigate for themselves. And that not everybody's the same, as we know. So it really was, we knew that each consumer had different shopping experiences and needs that we needed to provide based on them. And we had to let them have the ability to determine, you know, which product was best for them. So that was kind of the premise. And we decided, you know, really to guide them through all of our adaptive solutions. We had gifts, ways of showing how things work, detailing the benefits of each modification, empowering the consumer really to make the choice that's best solution for their lifestyle. And that's how we thought about that. And we found that to be helpful, and we can always get better. We're constantly looking at ways to innovate, ways to evolve, ways to improve. And that's why you constantly have to circle back in and keep co-creating and listening to this community.
Yeah, and it's a process.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah. So for, I mean, you've done tons of different articles of clothing, projects, you know, and so forth. Was there any project or I guess line of specific clothing, article of clothing, I should say, that kind of did not go according to plan? And if so, what happened?
Yeah, you know, we're still working on one of them. I'm excited about it. But I felt so strongly that we needed to have an adaptive bra, you know, and
idea.
Yeah. And it just seemed like, you know, and we had ideas around a really interesting solution that allowed the bra to maintain its sporty or sexy or, you know, whatever the intent was. We didn't want it to look clunky and right, you know, just the way we see what's going on in intimates and all these parts of the business where people want a product like anybody else is getting. And so it was challenging. We working with the manufacturers on it. Trying to get, they said 3 to 5 magnets. We thought that was too bulky. We thought they were too big. And yet how are we going to get them to, you know, hold in terms of, you know, really having the ability to hold firm on the closure. And they just weren't attractive at first. So we finally asked some of these manufacturers to develop our own mold for a 2-magnet design. And it's been a lengthy process. It's been interesting, but we've patented this design now. And we're very excited about it. We can't wait to see how customers are gonna respond, but we think we're onto something really great here. And so that's one that was challenging. We think we've overcome it by literally inventing what we needed to, working with the manufacturer on what our ideas were. And I think we have something pretty special.
It's amazing. And so, you know, actually, when it comes to, you mentioned bras, but what about like 2-piece bathing suits and, you know, because I'm just thinking of like the bra, have you thought about using some of the same modifications, or I don't know if that's something you've
even. Yes, swimwear is another one that we're still working on, but yes, some of those, the really good ideas, you know, can also work across into other categories. Yes. Yeah,
absolutely.
And we want people to wear what they want to wear just like anybody else. And I think that this solution translates into the swimwear as well. So
I'm coming. And once that's done, I just realized I'm coming. You'll have a new consumer for the adaptive line.
We've also seen, and others have been working in this way, I think we're further along on a lot of these innovations in technology and things, but sensory friendly product has been a big deal. And so just literally, you know, tagless shirts. I mean, you don't want tags and things bothering anyone. So we've integrated that in as well. And so have some other companies done that. Underwear is another very interesting one with kind of these hook and loop closures on the leg openings. And so we've got some very, I think, interesting ideas around underwear that we've been putting out there already and keep evolving. And areas where, you know, some of the other business partners that we've been excited that have gotten into the space, like a Nike with their Flyy shoe, but footwear is a big opportunity and a big challenge. So we're constantly working on that. We've got some cool bag ideas, you know, and things that work with wheelchairs and accessories and all that. So just to make it easier. And I think, you know, these things are all in the works and we're not going to stop innovating and we're going to keep going, you know?
Yeah, keep going. It's important. Yeah. So, and we spoke about, I mean, different types of your clothing modifications, but what is the most popular, at least right now, article of clothing that you see your consumers buying?
You know, I mentioned the easy zip and opening outerwear.
Right.
That's been really, really great. And by the way, that would be good for anybody, right? Think about
it. Yeah, I'm thinking, yeah, totally.
Think about with kids, you know, trying to get their outerwear together. I mean, it works. And some of the adaptations, quite honestly, yes, we develop them with people with disabilities in mind.
Of course.
But some of these things are just good innovation for dressing easier, right? And certainly for the elderly who have challenges with their hands and dexterity and arthritis. So, you know, but that one's been really good across the board. For sure, all of our shirts where it's just easy to go like this and close them with the magnetic buttons have been really, really popular. And then other things with dresses and t-shirts where it's easier to get in and out, whether it's back open enclosures or things. But again, all concealed and hidden in a way where our objective here was, we want the exact same product that our customers love and from us every day. This isn't like a separate line of designing new things. It's modifying the line that everybody wants and just enabling people to dress themselves, you know, more independently. So it's many of those same things that are popular day in and day out. We have this one t-shirt, which has the Tommy flag across the front of it. It's a best seller day in and day out called the Tino T. That's been a home run with our customers. They love it. And we've made it easy to get in and out of it. So similar kinds of things across the board.
Yeah, for sure. And it's funny that you say people that are not disabled, even though you make the clothing for people with disabilities. It's funny. People always are like, well, you can have your disability to your advantage. I mean, I've used a steering wheel for driving, for an example. I don't need it, but it's on my license. And you know, if someone's driving my car, they're like, well, can I have this, please? And so, no, but just translating it into clothing. I mean, there's things that just make life so much easier. And the regular person that doesn't have a disability, you know, doesn't necessarily think of. So
That's right. In
terms of your audience, I mean, are you seeing, I mean, clearly the population primarily is the people with disabilities and so forth, but are you seeing in medical conditions, are you seeing any audience or consumers that are, like you said, we were talking about just, you know, general people, they just want something easy to, you know, snaps to, you know, for a coat or is it still primarily those who have disabilities?
You know, I don't really have the data on those that don't. I'm not sure if those coming on, or maybe someone's buying something for a loved one and they're saying, right. Oh, wow, I like that too. I don't know that. But what we do know is that that 1 in 4 have a disability and that 4 in 5 either know someone or have a loved one with a disability. So there's a big target audience, right? We know that. And we'll keep innovating and doing what we think is really going to meet needs. And then it'll be interesting to see over time how some of the innovation may work more universally.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. So where can you buy Tommy Adaptive? Clearly there's the website. But do you also sell Tommy Adaptive in your stores, or is it, you know, more inclusive, you know?
So we've started this business. We've talked until COVID came, we were really getting ready to test some in stores. And even tested in the way where it's more universal design and people could come in and go, oh, wow, by seeing an item that's so easy to dress, they might come in and go, oh, that would be great for someone I know that could use that. Right. We weren't necessarily going to market it as adaptive in the stores to start.
Right.
We were thinking about it. But again, with COVID, everything got kind of slowed down around that. But where we do sell it, and we really started mostly with the idea, let's start online, get this moving, and then eventually we'll expand our distribution. But for now, it's Tommy.com, which is important to us. We sell to Amazon in a pretty big way. We sell to Zappos, and we sell to Macy's.com. So we're on those sites
Amazing. Now
and really looking at distribution opportunities. You know, as the world kind of normalizes a bit, I think there'll be a number of other places we can take it, including to bricks and mortar.
But you've thought about, like, you know, also doing other department stores such as Bloomingdale's or, you know, Saks that sell your products and clothing
line. I think that there's no question we wanted to do it and really take some time to understand and get it right. Now we're open. The more we can expand it out, the more awareness we can create, and the more places we can show up, the better. So it's just really, I think, as over the coming months, we'll be evaluating that distribution strategy. Nothing is set yet, but we'll be looking at it. The other thing to be aware of is I always had the dream that this could be global and international because this is a global issue. And so we did launch this year on Tommy.com and, of course, during COVID, but we got some very good initial reaction on our Europe site, our Australia site, and our Japan site. And they've all been very enthusiastic about it and excited. It's so much, again, a part of our purposeful initiative of what we want to do and how we want to show up in the world, much more than just selling clothes, right? We want to be much more to our consumers and what the brand will stand for. So that's been exciting to see that already we've got some global presence. And again, I think anything's possible. Yeah.
I think so. And you guys are definitely going to go to that degree. I've beyond confidence that you will. So I'm excited to watch you guys grow. Great. There are other designers, not as many clearly as we spoke about in fashion that are starting adaptive clothing selling quote unquote adaptive clothing. I mean, there's Zappos Adaptive,
yes.
Target. How do you think, or how does Tommy Adaptive stand out from the other lines that are out there right now?
Yeah, look, I think that anytime you look at Tommy, you got to start with our kind of cool American style, you know, because we have a certain style as a brand with our DNA that we think sets us apart to start with. And I think we're a little more upscale than any of the other adaptive stuff that's going on so far. So we're trying to be more fashion, more elevated a little bit. So I think that's different now, but anyone who's doing it, it's great, right? And again, the fact that we are end-to-end, as I mentioned earlier, our inclusive design approach to things and our marketing and our selling, everything we're doing around it, I think we've evolved pretty nicely. And the fact that we've worked so closely with this consumer to understand their needs, to co-create with them, we did that from the very, very beginning. I didn't want to even get started until we started with the consumer and got the fact-based data and really learned from them. So I think we've done a lot, spent a lot of time on very serious research. And I think that separates us out compared to perhaps what others have done so far. I hope they all jump in, you know, and really go after it with the same level of commitment and passion that we have.
Yeah, I would hope so too. Yeah. How have you seen the fashion industry evolve in terms of disability inclusion?
Well, look, when we first started, no one was doing much in 2016. Right. And so since then, and with Mindy working in a partnering way to get the word out and to connect with other companies, because this is not about Tommy Hilfiger or PVH. This is about a mission to lead a movement to get the fashion industry to recognize that you have all of these consumers out there that have not been served. They've been overlooked.
Right, of course.
Okay, so what I think is, you know, we're at the point where I just think there's no excuse not to be inclusive anymore. And this is the word we want to get out. So we've certainly seen Target. We talked a lot to Kohl's about it. They started to do something. We talked to, you know, obviously Nike was already doing some things in the footwear, but we've been very, you know, really collaborative and getting Amazon excited. Amazon is very excited about it. And I think they'll continue, as they do with everything, to build, right? And do more with it. So that's exciting. So I think that it's about getting the industry more and more aware. And that's why the business case could be very important to get others excited, because if they can see, ooh, this is not only good because it's purposeful and will connect with our consumers in ways that we otherwise might not, we can get new consumers like we've proven here, and there's real business to be done and it's global. I think these are the kinds of things we just need to get that word out there more and more and show more brands. And Mindy's constantly out there, you know, working the room, so to speak. And that's been great. We just need more. We need more of that awareness.
Absolutely. And yeah. I should say, I mean, clearly you presented this idea to Tommy himself when you came up with this idea. What was his, and I don't know if there's any personal, you know, affiliation with him personally or, you know, whatever. Oh, there is. Okay. But so what was his, I mean, I'm sure his immediate reaction was like, oh my God, we should
go start. Immediately, we have to do it.
Okay.
Okay. It wasn't even a question. Passionate about it. He's been involved with us every step of the way. Of he is so supportive and committed. And he does have some children who have some challenges. So
they do. Okay. I didn't know. So
he's lived it firsthand. But he's an amazing man who always wants to do the right thing. He's always been about the democratization of fashion anyway, and inclusion and diversity. So for him, it was such a natural to really be leading this movement. And he's been a phenomenal partner in it.
I'm sure. That's amazing. Yeah. Have there been any types of modifications that people or consumers have requested that maybe you haven't even thought about until it was brought up?
You know, I think some of the things around footwear and underwear and some of those things that I mentioned. So, you know, when they've been requested, we start working on them for sure. You know, better accessories that work with their, if they're seated. Also quite a bit around people in wheelchairs and how the fits need to be completely evolved. So, you know, on some things you can have your exact shirt or your outerwear piece and you just apply the modifications. When it comes to being seated for many, many hours during the day, as it relates to, you know, comfort and circulation of air and just ease of getting in and out of the way, there's a lot more complexity to that. So there were a lot we learned about people asking for things there, and we've used quite a bit of that to put into the product for people who are seated in wheelchairs.
Yeah, and I would actually, I mean, I would imagine also that your consumers play a big role. I mean, clearly it could also be like, you know, Tommy's children and, you know, your niece or your father-in-law too, but, you know, and other people and, you know, that work for you that have personal connections. Because, I mean, they're the ones that are using it, and obviously you want the feedback. So
that's where you get the best feedback. Absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. What advice would you give to others that want to go into the adaptive, like, fashion space?
Well, I think, you know, it starts with you've got to involve the community. You need to give them a seat at the table. And that, to me, has been so critical to our learnings and our ability to service this community and to have success. I also think there's a number of organizations. What we've done is we partnered with the Special Olympics. We outfitted the team. It was unbelievable. We worked with actually a close friend of mine from college, started a home in Roswell, Georgia called Champions Place for young adults with disabilities. And we partnered with him and we outfitted these kids. They were doing, you know, marathons and wheelchairs and all different things. And we also partnered with Google, who has created unbelievable technology for this home that these young adults are going to live in. And it's an amazing thing. The home is literally a fully assisted living home in really progressive ways. And it all started because we got into this. And then I called the people at Google. They were like, oh my God, we love this space. We do so much for accessibility and all this. And they have been working super closely. So it's reaching out to the network of like-minded organizations and or organizations that are involved, like Runway of Dreams or Special Olympics or whatever it may be, and partnering up and then getting the good vibe going. And I find that everyone we've worked with, from, you know, the Wunderman Thompson group, when we first brought it to them, they couldn't wait to work on this thing, right? So really, if you find the right kind of people and the right kinds of organizations, the passion and the energy around it and the feeling of wanting to do the right thing, it's contagious. Mm-hmm. And so I recommend that people tap into that and to people wanting to do the right thing and to help others. And then, you know, of course, embracing technology. And that's really been critical. Collaborating with the consumer, looking at innovative ways to market this idea, creating shopping experiences like we talked about, guiding them through to make it easy to navigate and understand how to buy for their particular needs. And then just thinking about being inclusive in all of your efforts in every way that you work, in every aspect of your work. I think really, if you get that mindset, you're well on your way.
I think that's great advice. So lastly, what do you envision Tommy Adaptive, or where do you envision Tommy Adaptive to be in the next 10 years? What are your goals?
Yeah, you know, to me, the big win is when the world embraces it and brands embrace it in a significant way. So the fact that we've already accomplished what we have and have a global presence already shows me this is all going to be really possible. I think it's pushing the boundaries of what's possible. Like, don't let anything you know, stop you from pushing forward. So it's constant innovation. It's constantly connecting with the community and understanding and learning all the time how to do it better. And then getting the word out there. And this is why I also was so excited to have this interview, because anything that creates awareness to other people, to inspire them and motivate them to want to get in on this incredibly big business opportunity of this unbelievably underserved community where there's so much white space, I think is something that's great. And when the world embraces that and more brands recognize it and start to get involved, that's what I'm excited about. And then I think we really change the world and the way people, you know, think about people with disabilities and the way we service this community.
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, that's one reason why, obviously, I started Different Enable. And
I love it.
You know, thank you. And we're definitely, I mean, we're growing and, you know, I mean, you too. I mean, we're all like, you know, raising awareness and, you know, trying to make change, because, you know, a person who has a disability or a medical condition is still a person, and they have every equal right to be treated the same way. Absolutely. Disability is just, or medical condition is just one part of them.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And, you know, of course, there's so many other aspects to it that you start to learn about, like the unemployment within people with disabilities, what happens to these young adults, like at Champions Place, that literally the funding runs out, their parents are aging out, where do these kids end up? So all of the aspects around this community and this world, there's so many, just, you know, as you get more and more into it and learn more, it's an eye-opening thing to realize, and we need to be proactive.
Absolutely. And actually, I'll tell you one thing. I mean, and you can definitely go on the site and see the video, but when I interviewed Governor Patterson talking about just unemployment, I didn't know this, but he had said that the ADA doesn't cover those that are legally blind, which I wasn't aware of. And then he said the workforce is just impossible, to, you know, because they don't cover the types, you know, software. And I was just in awe. I had no idea.
We have a long way to go on that.
Yeah,
part.
We do. And it's just, you know, so
a lot of it starts with just educating, you know, companies and people on what is this landscape and how can we make a positive difference? And it's going to take time, but I think it's all going to happen.
It is. And you guys are going to make it happen regardless. So you guys are at the forefront. So thank you so much, Gary. This is wonderful.